Thank you. I'm so glad to be here with all of you, Catholic friends. The topic that I'm going to be speaking about is something I think that we're all interested in, and that is, what is Catholic life like? And because of our topic, we're talking about Catholics in colonial America. And I think that some of us can almost imagine, within a generation or two, what daily life would be like there in 200, 400, 300 years ago. As other speakers have pointed out, there were political problems that cannot be separated from religious problems and from religious identity. What the colonial American Catholics shared was not the same church, the same denomination, the same religion. They shared a common European, mostly Northern European culture in the colonies. They were English, mostly. There were Catholics, as we heard about from the last speaker, in Maryland. There were some others. There were Puritans in the New England states as we know them. There were Quakers in Pennsylvania and in Rhode Island. And curiously, some of these troubles led to a certain kind of unexpected, you might say, religious toleration in an atmosphere which was extremely intolerant of any deviation from one's own variety of the Christian faith. The Puritans, as you know, left precisely because they'd been persecuted. But what happened? They began enacting laws to persecute other people. The same thing happened in the colony of Virginia, which was loyal to the Church of England, and the Church of England was established in Virginia as the only church usable. So Puritans were not tolerated in Virginia. Church of England people were not tolerated in the New England states. In Maryland, curiously, and also in Pennsylvania, and also Rhode Island, were the three states which had some, at least tacitly on the books at some point of their colonial history, religious toleration. One of the most interesting ones, there were troubles almost from the beginning. You heard in the last speaker told us about the Ark and the Dove, and in 1634, on the Feast of the Annunciation, the first Mass was said in that territory. Probably Father White, who was quoted by the last speaker as saying this was the first time this had ever occurred, probably Father White was unaware that there had been a failed attempt by Jesuit missionaries, of course, to establish a Catholic mission in Virginia around 1570. It failed. The colonial Christian religion, divided as it was into denominations, we have to remember that what was going on was so close following the Reformation. 1620, when the pilgrims came to Plymouth, was less than 100 years after Martin Luther's famous act in the Church of Wittenberg, and every kind of chaos had been going on in Europe during that time. So when they came over in 1620 as a statement of religious freedom, it was not a philosophical position that they wanted to tolerate every religion, by no means. Troubles began with dissension and disputes about religion and generally paralleled that of the mother country, wherever they came from. And there were so many of the religious battles were also politically inspired, were more over politics or property than they were over matters of essential Christian belief. An interesting thing that I found when I was looking at this was one of the very earliest acts of religious toleration was in Maryland in 1649. I think that's significant because, as we heard from our last speaker, Maryland was established by a Catholic as a province, you might say, in what became colonial America. Let me read you that Toleration Act, and it will probably sound a little bit familiar in places. It said, "The enforcing of the conscience in matters of religion hath frequently fallen out to be of dangerous consequence in those commonwealths where it hath been practiced, and for the more quiet and peaceable government of the province, and the better to preserve mutual love and amity amongst the inhabitants thereof, be it therefore enacted that no person or persons whatsoever within this province," speaking of Maryland, "professing to believe in Christ, shall henceforth be in any ways troubled, molested, or discountenanced for or in respect of his or her religion, or in the free exercise thereof, within this province, nor in anything compelled to the belief or exercise of any other religion against his or her consent." Now, this was the first ever effort to make religious freedom the basis of a state. And I think we can see how some of this fundamental issue is something that we are grappling with even in our own time about what religious freedom means and what political dimensions that may have. In 1682, that was in 1649. In 1682, when William Penn came over to establish Pennsylvania, it also enacted a religious toleration act. Now, he came over with Quakers, but he also had with him Dutch Calvinists and German Catholics and Swedish Lutherans. And so religious toleration was fundamental to the idea of Penn when he established the state. And in his language it said, "all such as profess faith in Jesus Christ would be free to exercise their religion." Now, it sounds like a very good and promising beginning, doesn't it? 1649, the Maryland Act. In 1650, Puritans who were driven out of Virginia, because Virginia only tolerated the Church of England, found hospitality in Maryland who had religious toleration. But were they grateful? They started a rebellion, as a matter of fact, and they seized the government of the colony. They convened a general assembly to which Catholics were declared to be ineligible either as members or as electors. And the first thing this illegal revolutionary body did was to repeal the Act of Toleration of 1649 and to enact another concerning religion, which contained this provision, that none who profess and exercise the papistic, commonly known as the Roman Catholic religion, can be protected in this province. Only one priest remained in Maryland. after Lord Baltimore was restored to power in 1658, the Toleration Act was also restored. But it kept going like this, back and forth and back and forth. More and more refinements and subtleties of anti-Catholic laws, which were on the books in virtually every colony. Catholics were disenfranchised because you had to take an oath of allegiance to the monarch of England and also to everything that he stood for, including some, in some cases, explicit renunciation of a belief in transubstantiation. Well, a Catholic obviously could not sign that act, and so Catholics were in effect disenfranchised. So Catholics could not vote. If there were Catholics, and there were few of them, one reason why we don't hear about great persecutions and so on of Catholics in colonial America is because the laws against having Catholics were pretty effective. If there were Catholics in some of the other colonies besides Maryland, and there were in Pennsylvania, and there were a few in Rhode Island, if there were Catholics, they kept their heads down. Nobody knew they were there. Now, some of the interesting stories about the colonial period involve the itinerant priests. Now, imagine, you're over here, imagine the situation, how many difficult times you had getting over to this country in the first place. Let's say there was one priest in Maryland. Let's say there were 500 Catholics sprinkled all over the country. There were a few in Pennsylvania. They didn't have priests. Well, now think of the difference in the Protestant churches. The Protestant churches didn't have the same ordination process. The Quakers shared with Catholics a deep commitment to the action of the Holy Spirit, but they did not have, as you know, ordained clergy. So any Quaker was free to establish their own church anywhere they wanted to. But what do you have to be a Catholic and to practice your faith? You have to have a priest. You also, in order to celebrate Mass, what else do you have to have? You have to have bread and wine. You have to have beeswax candles. You have to have altar vessels. You have to have linens. In other words, you have to have some semblance of a church or a portable church. You have to have vestments for the priest. I mean, in a way, we talk about sometimes we congratulate ourselves as Catholics that we're an embodied religion, that we are not something that is disembodied, that it matters what matter is. Well, as a matter of fact, matter mattered to those Catholics too. In some cases, where there was a priest, he couldn't celebrate Mass because he didn't have any wine. In one case, in the missions, the priest couldn't celebrate Mass because it was required to have beeswax candles, and he had no candles at all. So there is something about the stuff of the culture, the Catholic culture, that was missing, for the most part, in colonial America, and in some cases, in some of the missions as well. Things that were going on in Europe, of course, because these were colonies, European colonies, English colonies. So the 1688 rebellion in England, William and Mary took over the province of Maryland, of course, because it was their province, and they appointed a governor. Now, Lord Baltimore was allowed to retain his property there, which is the reason why we have a Maryland and why it wasn't absorbed into Pennsylvania and Virginia, because Lord Baltimore was allowed by the crown to keep the property. But the Act of Religion was passed whereby all of the penal laws against Catholics, that applied in England were applied to all the colonies. These laws established the Church of England as the established church in Maryland. So if we have an illusion, in a way, of Catholic Maryland, well, it's true up to a point, but it wasn't free to be Catholic. In fact, nobody in the colonies was really free to be Catholic in those years, except intermittently and from time to time. And that's another reason why it was difficult to be a Catholic in the sense that we're Catholic, because they didn't really have churches. As you may know, in England during the Reformation, priests were sort of hidden, and they would have little priest holes, and they would have little chapels in the houses where Catholics would have mass from one of these courageous priests who would sneak back into England from Europe. Well, the same thing, in a way, was true here. There were the Jesuits' missions in Maryland, and they were sort of tolerated because they were pretty remote. They were rural. That one that Father mentioned in a little Bohemia was away from, and the Jesuits had these plantations by which they maintained themselves. The people who came over to the colonies in Maryland were landed people who had servants, most of whom, as someone mentioned, I think, were Protestant. The economies changed, too. In the New England states, most of the people who came over were middle-class people who were tradesmen or small farmers or whatever, but the people who came to Maryland, who were the Catholics and established the Catholic outpost, you might say, in the New World, in New England, or in the colonies, were landed gentry, and they came over with servants. And their economy developed along that line. When somebody mentioned that 40,000 pounds of tobacco were given by the Jesuits, where did that tobacco come from? It came from their huge plantations that came to be run by slaves. The converts that were made in what is now Maryland to the Catholic faith, a lot of them were slaves that belonged to the planters and plantation owners in Maryland. It is also a case that the governors and the leaders, Lord Baltimore, one of the Lords Baltimore in 1715, the son of that Lord Baltimore, his successor, apostatized, and his son also, and they became the fifth Lord Baltimore, and they restored all of the anti-Catholic laws. Here's one that I think also gives us an indication of what Catholic life was like. So if you don't have priests, and you don't have catechists, and you don't have religious orders, how do you transmit the faith? In the home. Chiefly mothers. Mothers would teach their children the rudiments of the faith. They would teach them the prayers. They had prayer books from England that were popular prayer books, devotional books, some of them written by famous Bishop Richard Challoner, who happened to be the apostolic vicar for the colonies in England. And he had written some devotional books which were very popular. People survived with their faith on devotions, personal devotions, reading prayer books. They were encouraged to have morning and night prayer in their homes. Mothers taught the children their faith. So a particularly pernicious law that was enacted under the Lord Baltimore in 1715, who had apostatized, no longer a Catholic, was the so-called widow's law. They were aimed at making sure that the Catholic faith could not be transmitted, that it can't spread. It's a disease. We want to truncate it. If we can't kill every Catholic and make it stop that way, then we will make sure that it is not taught. So the widow's law, Catholic widows in Maryland were to be deprived of their children. The law says, I'm going to read this, provided always that where any person being a Protestant that shall die and leave a widow and children, and such widow shall intermarry with any person of the Romish communion, or be herself of that opinion and persuasion, it shall and may be lawful for His Majesty's governor and council within this province, upon application to them, made to remove such child or children out of the custody of such parents and place them where they may be securely educated in the Protestant religion. Catholics were not only disenfranchised, they couldn't vote, they couldn't be members of assembly, they were barred from holding any public office in Maryland and other states, other colonies. 14 years later, you would think they would have learned better, but that same Catholic widow's law of 1715, in 1729, Maryland intensified the widow's law and gave power to any county justice to take the child, and there was no appeal from this law. So if you're a Catholic mother and you've got several children and your husband dies, they can or will be taken away from you so that they will not be raised as Catholics. And the other colonies followed suit with these laws. This was a way of stopping the spread of the faith at the beginning with the mother. In 1755 and 1760, and again in 1762, North Carolina, Maryland, and Virginia all had these laws regarding guardians. Parents, other parents except Catholics, might leave the rearing of their children to someone designated in their wills, except for Catholics. And in that case, in North Carolina, actually, the Quakers were included in that. They didn't want Quakers either. So to any person or persons you could leave your children, the raising of your children to any person or persons other than the people called Quakers and the Popish recusants. The Jesuits' lands were taken from them at about the same time. And priests who refused, they had to refuse that oath of supremacy, which would renounce their faith. All the Jesuit lands were taken away, and the law in 1756 said any person educated in a foreign Catholic seminary could not inherit or hold lands in the province of Maryland. Now, at about this time, the Catholic population in Maryland was about 9,000, and the number of priests in the whole territory was 8 to 15. At that time, Bishop Chaloner, who was the apostolic authority in England overseeing this church, put the number of priests in the whole province at 12. And he, Bishop Chaloner, wrote to Rome saying, I can't supply priests. They need priests. We need to do something. And later, as we know, John Carroll, after a series of years and interventions, was made a bishop ultimately. What, if anything, can we learn from any of this, except for to maybe satisfy a certain historical curiosity. Well, folks, we have inherited what was given to us by the by these early Catholics, and one of the most, I'm going to talk just a little bit about John Carroll, who was the first bishop in Maryland, because I think it's interesting because he's sort of a transitional figure. He was born in 1734. He was sent, as the wealthy people in Maryland, Catholics in Maryland, did routinely, sent him to Europe when he was 15 years old to be educated in a Catholic school there. He joined the Jesuits, he stayed there, and he taught for a number of years. He was still there when the Jesuits were suppressed. This broke his heart. He wrote to his mother that he might as well die. This was his whole life. But instead, he came back to Maryland and worked within the church in the colonies and became the first bishop. You heard already about the prominence of the Carrolls, the signer of the Declaration of Independence. One was a Carroll, and that gave him a certain, that gave Catholics a certain respectability among the revolutionary figures of the time, and that had an effect. I just want to digress just a little bit. We were talking about what the Catholic churches looked like. Well, essentially, there weren't any for a long period of time. When the churches were built in the New England area, they would have looked pretty much like the other churches in New England. One of the things that I think that is interesting about this weekend for all of us is because we can see we're part of this whole country is us now. So we're related to those Catholics in New England, and we're related to the Catholics in the Southwest and in the North, and those in Louisiana and the missions in Florida. These are all relatives of ours. We are now united by religion, but we still have distinct cultures. For example, in the mission churches in the Southwest, if any of you receive the Adoramus Bulletin, next month there'll be an article about a brand new reredos, or big altarpiece, that's being installed in the mission of San Juan Capistrano. That is a new church that was built 20 years ago to replace one that had been destroyed by a terrible earthquake 400 years earlier. This new reredos, big altarpiece, is beautiful and gold and splendiferous, and it was made by a group of Spanish artisans, and it's just been installed within the last month. But the style of it would be utterly foreign to anyone who had been a Catholic in New England. It's Spanish Rococo, gold everywhere, and twisted columns and grapes and cherubs and doves, and it's quite splendid. So we do have distinct cultures that still exist with us, and we know that this is something that we're going to be contending with, challenged by, in the foreseeable future. We have a huge immigrant population now from Southeast Asia, many wonderful Vietnamese Catholics. We have the Hispanic population, which has burgeoned in the last few years. We have, you know, and we had the European immigration throughout the 19th century, which gave the character, I mean, gave the Catholic Church in America the character that it has now. And in large part, that immigration in the 19th century, principally from Ireland and from Germany, gave character to the church and gave it its substance. as we can see, we've seen from this, the church in this part of the world that we now call the United States was virtually non-existent. There wasn't a Catholic culture in the sense. In the missions in the Southwest, for example, each mission was its own community. It had to be, because you can't minister, you can't minister to and form a person in religion unless you have contact with them. And so they had to make these communities, and they enforced the, it was rigorous, almost like a college campus. The women were quartered in one dormitory and the men in another. The only kind of community that you could transmit the faith to was a settled community. This was different in the missions than it was, of course, in the colonies, where the culture was in common, even though the religion was widely varying, the practice of religion, that is. But in the missions, for example, the native Spanish art, the native art of the American Indians was incorporated, the colors, their sense of colors, the kind of ceremonies and festivals they had in the Southwestern missions were, to some extent, still exist and very much gave character to that whole area of Catholic practice, of the Catholic faith. It is different, was different, still is different in New England. And yet, what unites us is not culture, as it were, except to the extent that it is Catholic culture. And that's one thing that I think is something that we will be considering in our lives that will affect us. Not only the political ramifications of what it means to be a Catholic and what that requires of us, but also the cultural dimensions of what it means to be a Catholic and how that is transmitted. Some things don't change. It's still going to be a lot of responsibility on the women who teach our children, either in Catholic schools or the mothers in the home. I want to return again to Bishop Carroll, who's in our period again. He's, as you know, related, as we learned in the last speaker told us, to the Charles Carroll of Carrollton, who signed the Declaration of Independence. In a defense of Catholics, John Carroll was appointed bishop by Pope Pius VI in 1789. Curiously, 1789 was also the year that we became a country. Also interesting, the suppression of Jesuits was the same year as the Boston Tea Party. So it is interesting to follow the dates, because you can make certain connections. It would be kind of fun to have a timeline on all this, wouldn't it? And to say, oh, this was happening here, but this also was happening here. As it is, when we talk about it in paragraphs, it gets a little confusing. But some of those connections are kind of interesting to make. In 1776, as our last speaker told us, John Carroll went with Benjamin Franklin and a couple of other people to see if they could get the question of union and neutrality in the revolution with the Canadians. It didn't work, but anyway, this was a participation by prominent Catholics in the revolutionary aspect, and I think this is important. In June of 1789, Bishop Carroll said, in defense of Catholics, their blood flowed as freely, in proportion to their numbers, to cement the fabric of independence as that of any of their fellow citizens. They concurred with perhaps greater unanimity than any other body of men in recommending and promoting that government from whose influence America anticipates all the blessings of justice, peace, plenty, good order, and civil and religious liberty. In 1790, George Washington supported Roman Catholics of the United States explicitly. After the American Revolution, the anti-Catholic laws in most states changed, and freedom of religion became the law of the land. Bishop Carroll exerted profound influence over the way in which Catholicism would develop then in the new country. In 1791, only 2 years after we had become a nation, he called the First Synod of Baltimore, and it was attended by 22 priests of five nationalities. To train priests for his diocese of 3 million square miles. Now, there were only a few Catholics. It was a fairly small population, but it was a huge territory to administer. And he needed, what did he need? He needed priests. So one of the things that he had asked the fathers of the company of, now remember that the Jesuits had been suppressed. He asked the fathers of the Company of Saint-Sulpice to come to Baltimore, where they arrived in 1791 and started the nucleus of St. Mary's College and Seminary. That was one of his first priorities. In 1792, Bishop Carroll wrote a pastoral letter, and in this pastoral letter, he stressed three things. If I had time, I don't know if I do, I'd like to read you just a little bit of it, just to get the, capture the language. But the three things that were mainly on his mind were urging people to donate, to maintain the seminary and the priests. They would not have religious orders. The Jesuits were history for that time being. So the people themselves had to manage to maintain their clergy financially, support them, to build churches, to maintain the churches that they had, and to donate to the poor. So one of the main thrusts of his message, the first thing that he mentioned, was to exhort people for, he went on for several pages, to get people to donate. And then he also mentioned how important it is to the continuation of the faith to establish a school. Now, the landed people and the well-off people in Baltimore, in Maryland, had sent their kids to Europe, as you know, their boys went to Europe to school. But that was, we're America now. We have to have our own schools. So by his pastoral letter of 1792, a copy of which I happen to have with me, just by accident, Christian instruction of youth is a principal object of his pastoral solicitude, as he says it, and I'm just going to read you this little bit. Wherefore, fathers and mothers, be mindful of the words of the apostles, and bring up your children in the discipline and correction of the Lord. In doing this, you not only render an acceptable service to God and acquit yourselves of a most important duty, but you labor for the preservation and increase of true religion for the benefit of our common country, whose welfare depends on the morals of its citizens, and for your own happiness here as well as hereafter, since you will be assured of finding in those sons and daughters whom you shall train up to virtue and piety by your instruction and your examples, support and consolation in sickness and old age. they will remember with gratitude and repay with religious duty your solicitude for them in infancy and youth. So it is a very strong call to Catholic families to provide for the education of their children, not just in religion, but in religion. True. So the advantages of a religious education, he knew so well from his own experience, having been in Europe. So he says, I was solicitous for the attainment of a blessing so desirable to that precious portion of my flock, the coming generation. What does that sound like? Our Pope John Paul, World Youth Days? A school has been instituted, he says, at Georgetown, which will continue to be under the superintendence and government of some of my reverend brethren, that is, of men devoted by principle and profession to instruct all who resort to them in useful learning and those of our own religion in its principles and duties. I wish those of you who are able would send your children, your sons, to this school of letters and virtue. I know and lament that the expense will be too great for many families, but indirectly they will receive it at least, because his idea was, and this is a superb idea, you educate the children and then they go back to their communities and they educate the others. And by this means, since he didn't have the advantage of having huge missionary efforts, it was going to be a homegrown clergy, a home-educated clergy. It was going to promote and build the church in America by Americans. He also talks about the need to build and maintain churches. And I just want to read just one little tiny bit of this. I've gotten my 5-minute sign. He talks about the need for supporting a priest and supporting education, but he also talks about the need to maintain the churches. And here in this exhortation, this pastoral letter that he wrote, he sometimes speaks rather harshly to the people, which implies a lot about what the deficiencies in the practice of the Catholic faith that was common at the time. People had fallen into laxity because they didn't have priests. So I can't go to church, so therefore I excuse myself. And he talks about mass attendance, as a matter of fact. He talks about the need for chalices and vestments. He says about the churches, they are without chalices, without the decent and necessary furniture of altars, without vestments suited to the different services of the church, in a word, without those sacred utensils which its ordinances require and which contribute to impress the mind with a becoming sense of the majesty of religion and conciliate respect for its august ceremonies. Hence, finally, results the great evil and the source of many disorders, that by failing to make provision for the necessary support of pastors and the maintenance of public worship, you fail likewise of fulfilling the obligation of being present at Mass every Sunday and holiday. You lose the opportunity of receiving necessary and salutary instruction. And finally, an habitual disregard for the sanctification of the Lord's Day and for the exercise of prayer and religion becomes prevalent. You would find it interesting to read this pastoral letter. The reason why I think it is particularly interesting is that this was in 1792. The First Council of Baltimore had just happened. He was preparing the way for the church that would come. Bishop Carroll began building a cathedral in 1806. That cathedral, as you know, just last year was celebrating its restoration. I hope I get to see it when I go to the bishop's meeting, which is also again going to be in Baltimore this year. By the time that he built that, he had suffragancies in New York and Philadelphia and Boston and Bardstown, Kentucky, which then became, it was the westernmost diocese at the time. But you can see just in his tenure as bishop, how he set the tone for what would then happen in the 19th century when hundreds of our ancestors who were Catholic came to this country, German Catholics, Irish Catholic, and changed the face of the church and the face of this nation. Thank you very much.